I've heard that you measure almost everything in your personal life and in professional life. Is that true?
It's pretty much true. So the rumor is true. You know, I probably have a spreadsheet of 12 years of data about my heart rate in the morning, my mood in the morning, my workouts and all kinds of things. And in fact, I think as a physicist by training, engineer by training, I actually thought that with math and spreadsheets, you could pretty much solve anything, including finding a wife, which I did try, and I can tell you I failed at that. So don't try to use math for anything. But I'm definitely a huge believer in data in many ways. One is I believe that if you track something, just the act of actually tracking gives you focus into that specific measure. And I can give you an example from personal life, since you asked about tracking data. Around 2008, you know, I was in early 30s. I thought I was physically extremely fit. I was working 100-hour weeks, and I thought I was on top of my game. And I totally crashed. I started to lose my memory, and I couldn't focus on things. And I was running a company of about 200-plus employees at that point, which is rather embarrassing. So I realized I have to sleep more. Sounds like a very, very simple problem to solve. Wasn't easy for me, so I started tracking the number of hours I had slept the previous night every single morning. And suddenly, that alone changed my behavior. And obviously, as a company, we track hundreds of KPIs all the time, and it's totally transparent to employees. So I think tracking brings focus. And get back to you.
Yeah, well, I mean, how do data analytics help achieve success?
Well, we as a company, we're all about data. I would say the first one is the fact that when you track something, as I mentioned, it gives you focus. Second, I just think that data and analytics brings democracy to an organization. Give you an example. How often, I don't know you, I've certainly had these kind of emotional arguments about whether we should do A or B. And oftentimes, the person who's got the longest tie or you know, biggest paycheck or highest title makes the call. What we've tried to do is to use data as a way to kind of kill all the politics. And if it's the youngest girl or youngest guy in the room, we can make a case with data to say, hey, that's where the clients want to go. Well, that's the decision we do. So I think data can really democratize decision making. And secondly, I think if you have very good access to data, the cadence in your business can be so much faster. We have so many things that we track on real-time basis. So we have about 1 million to 2 visits, users coming to our service every single day. There's a number of things we actually change on a daily basis. If you don't have access to that kind of data, it may take a week, a month, a quarter before you get the insight and change something. So it can really sort of accelerate the pace at which you react to what your customer is doing, whether it's pricing or actually product combination.
That's very interesting. The CEO study of IBM highlighted that the customers demand and expect to get increasingly personalized and tailored services and products today. So the measuring everything, that's the key to that problem.
Well, measuring everything and having data obviously helps enormously. I think in most traditional businesses, you talked about customization and sort of customizing for a single customer. In most traditional businesses, people actually try to avoid customization because the more you customize, the more costs you have, platforms blow up, and you have so many different customer installations and maintenance is so expensive. So most businesses actually try to avoid. What we try to do, we've taken it to the other extreme. So we have 20 million plus consumers come to our service each month. We have tens of thousands of paying real estate agent customers. What we try to do is deliver a unique product or service to each one of these 20 million plus customers and users every month. How can we do that?
Yeah, exactly.
Well, we don't have hundreds of engineers somewhere in a room and trying to crank the new product or service experience every time. It's all algorithmic. But we use the data to customize your experience. So if you go to the service and I go to the service 15 minutes later, my experience is totally different. It's personalized based on what you've done in the past, where you've come from, and what are your preferences. And not only that, now we have a number of channels. Mobile has grown extremely fast. We have, whether it's Kindle Fire app from Amazon's using Amazon's platform, or Android, iPhone, iPad, mobile site. We try to deliver that customized service through each of these channels and devices as well. So it's a huge matrix of different potential combinations, what you might see, what you might experience, but it's all done algorithmically. And therefore, we can deliver. I don't even know how many different products or services we deliver each month, but it's a massive number. It's in tens of millions.
So now that the business is changing, as Peter here highlighted, can you give us all the old school companies some tips on shifting from manufacturing to the service markets? What should they find out about their customers, and how should they collect that information? Not an easy one.
It's a dangerous question. I think it's best if I talk about my and our own experiences, what we've done in terms of leveraging data and changing operations in that way. I think one thing is if you are serious about data and analytics and using that in some way or form, it has to start from the C-level. As one example, we hired a gentleman with the PhD in economics from Harvard. He's our chief economist in the organization. He's focused on leveraging the data and all the analytics in the organization. So I'd say the number one thing is, if data is as important as it appears that it is to a lot of CEOs, you have to make sure that the organization really knows that. Second point, when you have these massive amounts of data, it's actually a danger. When you can customize a lot of things, when you can measure a lot of things, the one big danger that you can have is that you sort of become incremental only. So it's incrementalism. You can measure everything, so you want to improve things by 0.2%, and you kind of lose the big picture and you miss some big opportunities. I would think most of you may have heard this quote from Henry Ford. He said, had I asked my customers what they want, they would have told me that a faster horse. And then he came up with the car. So I think one thing to keep in mind is, when you're sitting on this mountain of data, sometimes you can actually create totally new things. And one example from my world, real estate, we've collected so much data. We don't even know today what we might do with that data. But one example is, since we know where people have come to our service, what they're looking for, where they're coming from, as an example, we can build predictive models to tell you where the real estate market might be headed in 6 months' time. So it's a completely new product. So that's probably one thing to not just become absolutely incremental.
Thank you, Sami. Peter, do you have any comments on that?
Yeah, let me add one observation, which is actually an interesting paradox. If you would market to everybody in Finland, you don't need any personal information. You just put an ad on television or in the newspaper, and that's it. But the smaller the segment is you want to service, the more you need to know about the person. If you want to market to Arto, you need to know a lot
about Arto to make a proposal which is relevant to you. So the paradox here is, you know, the smaller your segments that you want to serve, the more you need to know. You know, and that's what is happening in today's world.